So thank you for inviting me to come to talk to you today. I'm going to talk about research and a recent research work. It's a joint work with Chris Holmes. So very different talk compared to the one from Mark before, so that's good. You have variety today. So as the title says, it's a Bayesian nonparametric method to quantify dependencies. So what do I mean by that? Let's go directly into the subject. You imagine you have a lot of variables. So here I have a gene expression. I don't know if this works here. So I have different genes. You can imagine that there are a lot of genes. We are in big data, it can be a lot. And for each gene, I have the level of expression of this gene in different cells. And I can have a big N or small n, not too small if possible. And what I want to know is, are two genes related to each other or not? So I don't look at all the correlation, I just look at pairs of genes, and I'm wondering, are the distribution of the two genes, the marginal distribution, related to joint? So I want to know, is there a dependence or not between these two genes? That's an example in biology, but of course there are different examples everywhere. It's very simple problems. We have X and Y, very simple notations too, and you have N observation, and there's pairs of observation like that, XI, YI, and you have a lot of them. So here, XI and YI are univariate. We are thinking about a more bigger data framework where XI and YI could be very big, but here, very simple, they are both univariate. That's fine, I can explain very easy things here. So far, people, at least in biology, when they have that kind of problem, they just do correlation, and if the correlation is small, say, oh no, there is no, everything is independent. So we know that correlation does work sometimes, but if it's not linear or if it's not monotone, you have nothing, and you don't find any relation, whereas there can be huge variation. So there are different methods. The one that is the best so far is this mutual information. So mutual information is very simple. It's a Kullback-Leibler divergence between the marginal of X and Y and the joint distribution. This is equal to zero if X and Y are independent, and it's big if they are not independent. The thing is that this is a number between zero and infinity. So what is dependent, what is independent? Where do you put the threshold? It's a bit difficult to know, but if you use this measure, that's quite fine. Since we are in a big data framework, well, here I just look at univariate, but this doesn't work very well if you are in higher dimension than that, because it's based on kernel density to estimate the density of PH, PY, P of XY, so kernel density will explode as soon as the dimension grows. And there are different approaches based on binning the, I'm French too, so I could speak in French, binning all the sample space, etc. Sorry, next time, just for you. So as the title say, I am going to follow a Bayesian non-parametric procedure. So let's look at why Bayesian, why non-parametric. So first, we are looking at a test framework. We could look at it in different ways, but we look at it as a test framework. So we have XI and YI, and they both come from two random variables, X and Y. And we are wondering, are these random variables independent or not? So the model M0 is they are independent, the model M1, they are dependent. Should not forget this order. So why Bayesian? Because I like Bayesian, I like probabilities, that's easy to work with. But that's not convincing enough. So first of all, we can include prior, and that's good because sometimes, for example, in gene expression data, we could know that two genes has been shown to be related to each other. And we may want to incorporate this information. In addition, we can have an explicit measure that is interpretable. We have a number that means that is the probability that these things are dependent. When you have a p-value, we know that it may be difficult to interpret. But if you have a mutual information, you have a number between zero and infinite. What does that mean? When do you say, oh yeah, I'm sure they are independent or dependent? You don't know what to say. And also, we can combine this number, this probability, with a lot of framework and within the decision theory framework, for example, and use that further. So that's why Bayesian and why non-parametric, because we don't know anything about the distribution of X and Y, and we want the method to be robust. we can want that to be for any type of application and not to depend on any special form of the dependence. So some of you know this slide, but for those of you who don't know, that's the idea of the approach, just with a small picture. I like to explain just with drawings if you don't know anything about non-parametric Bayesian. So if x and y are independent, we know that for any x, the probability of y conditionally on x is equal to the probability of y. So it doesn't depend where you are in x, the probability of y is independent on where you are in x. If they are dependent, it is not true anymore. So let's look at a very simple example. Here it's independent data. So whatever it's, if x is here or if x is here, below or above the average, then the distribution of y conditionally on x are the same. It's independent of x. Whereas let's look at a linear relationship here. So the data are the dots. If you look at when x is smaller than the average or when x is larger than the average, the probability of y given x is different. So this is a sign of dependence. The probability of y depends on where we are in the x space. And that's exactly the definition of being dependent or independent. Here is other data, so that's like kind of a parabolic data. And if we look at the first level, what I call the first level is this, divided just in two. If I divide x in two, here you look at this, the probability of y given x being smaller than the median or larger than the median, you don't see any difference. But if you look a bit closer and you focus just on this quadrant, for example, you see that there is a difference between the distribution of y being with x being here or x being here. So there are different levels. Sometimes at the first level you don't see anything, but you go further and you see that there are differences of these conditional probabilities. So that's the basic idea of the approach. So if you have to remember only one slide, you can remember that and sleep a bit until I finish the talk. So if you want to continue, I'm going to explain how it works. And so I'm using Bayesian hypothesis testing and Bayesian model selection. So I have two models, dependent, independent. So the simple way to do is to compute the Bayes factor. And this is the ratio of these two probability. So under the model M0, under independence, the joint probability is nothing else than the product of the two marginals. So if I have the probability of xy, the joint probability, and if I have the marginal, I can compute this thing. Okay, it's a big if because I don't have any of these measures. But if someone gives them to me, I can compute that and that's fine. I have the answer to your question. So using Bayesian non-parametric, basically I'm going to put a prior over the space of distributions. So I'm going to put a prior over the space of distribution in the marginal x, in the marginal y, and I'm going to learn p of x, p of y, and p of xy given the data. I know that some of you here never really done any non-parametric Bayesian, I guess, at least Ottawa students, New Year's, may not have seen that. So I'm going to go slowly into it. I'm not going to go into all the formalisms and all the formula. I'm really going to explain the method I'm using one, myself here, is Poliatri priors. Yes?
Can I just ask, when you say P of X and P of Y, are they actually different or is the P the same?
No, sorry, this one is the marginal distribution of the x, my x variables, and the other one is of y. So they are different.
They're different functions.
Yeah, I should have written p index x of x.
Okay, thank you.
I condensed my notation, but yes, they are different.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you for the question. I need everybody to understand that. So here I'm going to use Poliatri priors. There are a lot of different methods to do Bayesian non-parametric, so don't think that there is only Poliatri prior, not at all. But this is the one that I'm going to use here. So how does that work? Before introducing Poliatri priors and before explaining the Bayesian non-parametric part, I'm going to show you that using an infinite partitioning of any sample space, you can define a distribution. So imagine you have your sample space here, that could be the sample space of x or y in one dimension. You can divide this sample space in two, and then the other one in two, in two, in two, etc. And you have a binary, infinite binary recursive partition. So you can imagine that it goes into infinity. And you can also define probabilities to go to one side or another. So if you are here, you can say I have probability theta to go to the left and probability 1 minus theta to go to the right, etc., etc., etc. You have different ones, so theta 0, 1 minus theta 0, theta 1, 1 minus theta 1. And you can compute like that, all of them. That's something that you define. You fix this theta, you fix this partition, and this defines you a distribution over this sample space. Is it obvious for you that it defines a distribution? I have some nodes, I have some... Oh, my God, what is she talking about? So here is what I'm talking about. If you fix one set, for example, C011, I can compute the probability of this set, saying that I've been first left, then right, so it's probability of theta, 1 minus theta 0, 1 minus theta 0, 1. And I can do that for any set, even very, very far away. I just have a lot of multiplications to do. And if I want to simulate from this distribution, once all the theta are fixed, so if the theta are fixed, I can simulate from this distribution. I imagine that I have a point here. With probability theta, I go here. Theta, I go here, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if I fix all this theta, I can simulate from this distribution very easily. And here are three distributions. So I show them just stopping at the level of 5 here because I didn't want to go too far, but I could do much more. And so here I fix different thetas, theta, theta 0, theta 1, and I have a sample from this distribution, and that's the distribution probabilities. So for different thetas, you define different probability distribution. Oh, I have more and more nodes. I like that. So it seems that most of you followed that. That's perfect. Because now, so if I fix a theta, I have a distribution. This is for one, when I say theta is the vector of all the possible thetas, all the thetas here. So if I fix a theta, I have this one, another theta, another this one. Now I want to put a probability of all those possibles one. And what do? I just say I have this infinite binary recursive partition as before, but the theta are going to be random variables. So this one are random, and then I can this way construct a family of, an infinite family of possible probability distributions. The typical way to choose this random variable is a beta distribution, so with some parameters again, but that's just the thing. So if you understood how we can define a probability distribution using an infinite partitioning, then you just put some random variables on these branching probabilities, and that you obtain the Polya tree. It is a big name, it is just this. And so it's basically a class of distribution for random probability. So it's a distribution over distribution. Typically, people take alpha j0 and alpha j1 to be equal and proportional to k square, where k is the depth of the set. So it's here is depth 1, depth 2, depth 3, depth 4. So basically, this parameter increase with the depth. But that's not so important. That's more important for the people who know about Polya tree. So here I simulate from this Polya tree, and I simulate a lot of different distribution. Again, it will be completely smooth if I simulate further. I just fixed the level here. So that's Polya tree distribution, and that's exactly what I've done. The very, very, very nice property of Polya trees is that you can compute analytically, nearly, you will see after, my base factor. But how do you do that? So I'm still in one dimension. Imagine that you have so n observation of the x, so x1, x2, until xn. This sample can be summarized by the number of points that sets or belongs to each of our sets in our partition. So we say in the first sample, in the first partition here, all the samples are here. Then how many are here, how many are here, how many here, 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 etc. And that's a summary statistic of your data. And once you have that, conditionally on the partitioning scheme you choose, conditionally on all the parameter, and conditionally on the fact if you knew the theta, then the probability of your data is only the product of this multinomial distribution. So it's a theta j for the level j to the power, the number of data that belongs to this, that went to the left or to the right. That's just a multinomial. Now we know that the theta j are unknown and we have they are random variables, that we know the distribution. Distribution is a beta. And so we can integrate out. And the very nice property of that is that beta and multinomial are conjugate to each other. So we have that the probability of H given the partition and the parameter follows also, has this form basically. So it's a product of all the possible sets, all the possible sets in this partition. So it's an infinite product. And for each set, you compute this single thing, where that is a beta function only depends on the number of points that belongs to each of the sets. So it's a very, very, very simple function to compute. In MATLAB, you do that, in 3 seconds, it's here, you know. Complicated system method, but very, very simple to implement. So I have my first P of x. You were asking my P of x, my P of y. That's how I compute P of x. That's how I compute P of y. Then on the joint space, how does it work? On the joint space, it works exactly the same, except that we have a two-dimensional space. So I'm not going into the details here, but if you want to read about it, it's exactly the same system. This time, I divide each set in four. And so at the level one, I have one set, I divide it in four, and I compute the number of points that belongs here, 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 here. And at level two, I divide each of them in four again. And that's exactly the same principle. So the only difference is that instead of having a binary partition, I have a quaternary partition, and I have rectangular regions. There is a reason why it's rectangular and like that. We are interested in independence, so we are interested in the product of the marginals. Here, instead of being a beta distribution, it's a Dirichlet distribution, which is equivalent in four dimensions. And we can exactly write the likelihood in the same way. The only difference is that here we have a multivariate beta function. This is exactly the same. So basically, if you look a bit skeptic here, just read the paper, that's very easy. If you understood in one dimension, believe me for the second dimension, or we talk about it afterwards. That's simple generalization. So now I'm able to compute P of xy given m0, which is a product of the marginal, P of xy given m1, and then I can compute the base factor, and my job is done. The very nice thing is that both of these, all the probabilities can be factorized or are written as the product of all the possible sets of different terms. So this base factor can be itself written as a product of all the possible set of a term bj. And the very nice thing, you just have to do some calculus, but it's quite obvious. As soon as there is that a set contains zero or one data point only, so one or less, then bj is equal to one. So even though this is an infinite product of an infinite set of partitions, only the terms where that corresponds to sets with more than one data point has an impact here. So we can compute this thing analytically because we don't care about all the sets that are too low so that there is no data point into it. So we don't do any approximation analytically. We can compute this base factor exactly. And of course, if we assume equal prior belief, for the two models, we can express the probability of being dependent as 1 over 1 plus this base factor, and that's 1 minus the probability of being independent. So once we have the base factor, we can compute our probability of interest. So that's this very simple algorithm. I choose my partition, I compute this, and I give you that. Here is my video. That took a lot of time to make it work, but it seems to work. So here I'm going to show it in practice, how it works. It's a video that lasts 4 seconds, I think, so look very quickly. So my data are here. It's a sinusoidal data, made up, completely simulated, nothing real. X, Y, and I start by dividing my space in four dimensions, in four different rectangular. And I look, is this one, basically, I show you analytically how this works. But in practice, how this works, intuitively how this works, is that we compare this, 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 and this, and we look at, are they different, or do we see a difference, or can we see that there is independence? And at this first level, my algorithm will say, no way, my bj is quite high, it goes towards independence. Say, there is no real difference between here, here, and here, here. So it's quite independent. And I will show you, so it will appear step by step at different levels, so deeper in my division, how the evidence in favor of independence or dependence will go. So here I have to leave that because Flash doesn't want to be nice with me. So this is the movie, and that seems to play and play thanks to Seth. He made it play by infinite. That's it. So first we divide in four, and then we divide each quadrant in four, etc., etc., etc. I only show the four first levels because my screen is too small. When I am in green, it is that there is not enough, but there is one or less data point in this set, and so that this contributes to one. So we don't need to go further. If it is in red here, so all the green, we don't need to go further. If it is in red, we need to go further. I haven't shown the other one, but my algorithm computes the other ones at other levels. And so we see that at the beginning, the independence has most of the impact. And at the end of the algorithm, here, we see that there is a lot of evidence. It starts again. I will have to stop it at some point. Yes, stop. So at the end, well, we are nearly at the end here. At the end, for the level one, there is not evidence in favor of dependence. It's more of evidence in favor of independence. But at the level two, there are a lot of evidence in favor of dependence more than in favor of independence. So always it's a base factor. So both hypotheses are possible, and there are some evidence in favor of one or the other. Yes? Perfect. I'm nearly at the end. We see that the level 3 and 4 doesn't have a lot of impact in this case. And that's how the algorithm works. And then I combine all of this. So I do the sum because here it's a log of contribution. I do the sum and I obtain my base factor. Let's go back. Control L, yeah. So here it's just how it works on some simulated data. So here are five simulated data, and I show the probability of M1, so the probability of being dependent, when I either increase the size of the data set. So let's just look at the red line. The red line is the median over 500 runs, and then there are some quantile. So when I increase the number of data points for each of the models, the method detects that it's dependent indeed. And when I increase the level of noise, so how much noise there is on the data, it's less and less powerful, which makes sense. So after a while, you don't see any dependence. Here, what I show is similarly to the plot I showed you in the movie. So basically, for each of the model, that's a box plot because I run it 500 times. But where does the evidence for dependence or independence appear? And basically, for the linear models, it's at the first level that we can detect if there are differences and if it's dependent or not dependent. And for most of the others, it's at the second level that we observe most of the difference, the evidence in favor of dependence. We know that they are all dependent here. That's obvious when you look at these. So that was just to illustrate. And then we compared to other algorithms, because otherwise it's not really fair. Even if not, our algorithm is quite different in the term that it's the only one proposing and having a probability at the end and not just a number. But we compared them in terms of rock curve. And so rock curve, false positive versus true positive. Our method is the red. And when I say the red, it's both the red and the dotted red. You can ask after what is the difference. But our method is the red. And we see that the red, or the dotted red, is always as good or slightly better than the blue one. What is the blue one? The blue one is the mutual information used in the k nearest neighbor, which is the state of the art right now. So our method, or the dotted version of our method, is competitive compared to the state of the art method, which is mutual information. Our method also has a big advantage, is that we have a probability at the end, and not just a number between 0 and infinite. So what is the difference between the dotted red and the red, because you can say, oh, Sarah, you're cheating, you give us two curves, just say, oh, this one is the best. What is the difference is in the choice of the partition. So far, I didn't tell you at all how I choose the partition. So the easiest choice is, so here is my original data, some sinusoids data. First, I do a transformation to bring it to the 0,1 times 0,1 space. So to do that, I just use the inverse CDF of a normal distribution to be a bit robust. And that's what I do. And then I divide this space into equal quadrant. So that's what I showed in the movie. And that's my basic method. But this one is the red that doesn't work very well. This one is this red. The dotted red is a bit more complicated and works much better. Basically, I have this data set and I divide it in two parts, Z1 and Z2, two parts that are parallel to the y-axis, like that. And I shift them. So I take the Z1 and I put it the other side. I do that for a lot of different... No, I do that. And once I have that, I shift again into the 0,1, 0,1 space using the inverse CDF of a normal distribution. And then here, I do the basic quaternary. And I do that for a lot of different Z1, Z2. So instead of putting my Z1, my limit here, I could have put it here, 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 here. And I do that for a lot of them, and then I optimize overall. What does that mean? Is that that means that before we were just looking at comparing versus the basic quantile, like is it smaller than the median or the quartile, etc. Here now we are not interested at all on the order of the data. We can do any shift. What is important is P of Y given X independent of X or not? Whatever where we cut. And this is much more robust. Just to finish, we did some, we applied that on some single cell data. I don't have really to introduce you single cell data. Just if you want to do a project with me at some point, I'm really interested into biomedical data, and single cell data is something I work a lot on. So it's measuring some biological process, but at a single cell level and not at bulk of cell. And so here we had a set of 96 genes that are related in a pathway. For each of genes, we measured the expression level of these 96 genes in 288 different cells. And we want to know, okay, which genes are related to each other. So the first network I showed you at the beginning is someone who did exactly the same thing with the same data, but using correlation, and they found some correlation. Now I've done the same using our method to see what do we detect. So this is what we detect. Okay, that's a nice picture, but that doesn't tell you anything. Let's look at it in more detail, comparing our method with the correlation. So here is the dependence probability. So if it's 1, it's quite high dependent. 0 is not dependent. And that's the absolute correlation. So all the ones that have a correlation high, quite high, we detect them having a very high dependence probability. But there are some that we detect having a very high dependence probability where the correlation is not that high. And here I take two of these examples here where the correlation was 0.29 or around 0.3, and our probability of dependence was very high. And here are two examples that indeed doesn't look very correlated, and the correlation, because they are not linear dependents, but there is indeed something happening, and it's not independent. So that's what we managed to do. So here is just a summary. Basically, we derived a new method to do a Bayesian non-parametric way to test dependence on independence. The huge advantage of polyatry is that we can find an analytic measure of our probability, and it successfully detects independence or dependence. It compares to mutual information, which is a state of the art. In terms of future work, the aim is to improve the power of this method using different type of partition. Here I showed you that the partition has a huge impact, so maybe we could do further work here. And I've also worked on other approaches for the same problem using Dirichlet process mixture. Now I'm also working on the extensions to conditional independence and to independence in big data, really big data, where X and Y are not univariate at all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any question for Sarah? Yep. Indeed.
So when you're talking about the partitions, you said you tried a lot of different things and then optimized them.
Yeah.
What was your optimization criteria?
We maximize the base factor in favor of the, when I say in favor, is the we maximize the base factor to detect deepens. So we are biased towards deepens.
Right, okay, that was, yeah, okay, I see.
Yes, yeah.
What if you did those random partitions and just looked at correlations and biased towards higher correlations?
Sorry, can you repeat?
If you did those random partitioning,
yeah,
and then you just did something simple like the correlation again, and biased towards those partitions that gave you non-zero correlation.
So you mean
this
like...
This would also detect dependence,
you
right?
Mean doing that?
Yeah.
And then doing correlation?
Yeah.
No, I think it wouldn't. I haven't tried though, but okay. I don't think it would. Because there are a lot of... correlation just detect linear. So here I only split as rectangular here. I will not break all the... I will need to break completely the non-linearity part, and I don't to bring it into a linear. I don't think I will manage to do that.
Okay.
Yes.
Hi. I was wondering how does it scale with the number of dimensions in your data?
I don't think it scales well. That's why I'm working right now. We haven't tried this one on higher dimension. I'm working right now in higher dimension. And I don't think we are going toward this approach. Basically, the idea is that we are partitioning. So, except if we manage to do reduction of dimensionality before, in a way, to bring them in smaller space, but it's based on partition and it's based on doing binary. So,
yeah, so
I don't think it's going to scale very well.
You will have a lot of those green boxes in high dimensions because data is concentrated.
I don't think it's the approach to go for. In big data. That's not the one I'm going for, at least.
Okay, thank you.
Last question, perhaps. So you also mentioned that you optimized the partitioning.
Yeah.
So how does your algorithm compare with respect to the KNNMI approach you mentioned in terms of the computational time, let's say?
In terms of computational time, I haven't plotted that. But I run and I show myself, and it's nearly the same.
Okay.
So it would be interesting just to measure them exactly. But when I run, all of them run in a couple of seconds.
Okay.
And so I didn't find
here
it.
But you're looking at P choose 2, you know, so adding together, you would be, it is still makes a huge difference, right?
I didn't, even in this large dimensional thing, I didn't see any difference. It was a couple of minutes for both, and I didn't take the time of doing the ratio. But it seems very similar.
Okay, all right. Let's thank Sarah again.